Good morning, everyone. It is good to be together in worship on our sixth Sunday of Easter. Welcome to those joining us in person and those online and by telephone. We are blessed to be together today on this wonderful day. Our opening sentence of worship today is from John 14. If you love me, you will keep my word, and my Father will love you, and we will come to you. Please join in our processional hymn, number 461, verses 1 to 4. Stand up for Jesus. Please stand.
And Travis, could you turn on the front here? Thank you.
Welcome, everyone. Please be seated. I did see a note just a moment ago that our friends on Zoom might be have the volume a little low. This slide let you know. I'm not sure if our tech people saw that. It is great to be together today in worship. I'm really glad to have had the help of a number of people to help lead our service and prepare for it today. Thank you to Lloyd, our lay reader, who is here today to help me, as well as our reader and sides person extraordinaire, Ray Martinson. Thank you so much to Lennis and Travis at the back. We forgot to put Travis on there, but he's helping on the soundboard. Thank you. And music, thank you once again to Amy and for selecting the music and for providing accompaniment. Thank you to Michael, our vocalist, and Erica, who's also helping to sing. Actually, Travis is going to be filling in on the djembe from the back as well. He's wearing many hats today. And last but not least, thank you to Marion for helping out with our altar guild today. Please join us in our Gloria hymn, He Came Down, which is hymn number 368. We'll be doing verses 1 through 3. Please stand. Be seated for our first reading from Scripture.
Good morning. Our first reading today is from Acts, verse 10, or chapter 10, verse 44 through 48. While Peter was still speaking these words, the Holy Spirit came on all who heard the message. The circumcised believers who had come with Peter were astonished that the gift of the Holy Spirit had been poured out even on Gentiles, for they heard them speaking in tongues and praising God. Then Peter said, "Surely no one can stand in the way of their being baptized with water. They have received the Holy Spirit just as we have." So he ordered that they baptized in the name of Jesus Christ. Then they asked Peter to stay with them for a few days. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Sure. Our psalm appointed for today is Psalm 98, and our cantor Michael will lead us in the first verse. I invite you to join in the underlined verses.
Sing to the Lord a new song, for he has done marvelous things with his right hand and his holy arm. Has he won for himself a known his victory. His righteousness has he openly shown in the sight of the nations. He remembers his mercy and faithfulness to the house of Israel. And all the ends of the earth have seen the victory of our God. Shout with joy to the Lord, all you lands. lift up your voice, rejoice and sing. Sing to the Lord with the harp, with the harp and the voice of song, with trumpets and the sound of the out with joy before the King, the Lord. Let the sea make a noise and all that is in it. The lands and those who dwell therein. Let the rivers clap their hands. And let the hills ring out with joy before the Lord when he comes to judge the world. In righteousness shall he judge the world and the peoples with equity. Glory to the Father and to the Son and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
Please be seated for our second reading.
Second reading is from John, 1 John, chapter 5, verses 1 through 6. Everyone who believes that Jesus is the Christ is born of God, and everyone who loves the Father loves his child as well. This is how we know that we love the children of God, by loving God and carrying out his commands. In fact, this is love for God, to keep his commands, and his commands are not burdensome. For everyone born of God overcomes the world. This is a victory that has overcome the world, even our faith. Who is it that overcomes the world? Only the one who believes that Jesus is the Son of God. This is the one who came by water and blood, Jesus Christ. He did not come by water only, but by water and blood. And it is the Spirit who testifies, because the Spirit is the truth. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Please stand for our gospel acclamation number 709.
Alleluia, 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 alleluia. As the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. Now remain in my love. Alleluia.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to St. John.
Glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Now, as the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. Now remain in my love. If you keep my commands, you will remain in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commands and remain in his love. I have told you this so that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be complete. My command is this: love each other as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this: to lay down one's life for one's friends. You are my friends if you do what I command. I no longer call you servants, because a servant does not know his master's business. Instead, I have called you friends. For everything that I learned from my Father, I have made known to you. You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you so that you might go and bear fruit. Fruit that will last. And so that whatever you ask in my name, the Father will give you. This is my command: love each other. This is the gospel of Christ.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Please be seated. I speak to you today in the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Back in our first year of marriage, Krista and I moved to South Korea to teach English. I remember after we moved, becoming aware very quickly that things we normally thought were so easy and took for granted while living in Canada were just not going to be easy, living in a different culture where most people spoke another language. Things like taking public transit to go shopping or ordering food to eat off of a menu. The littlest things became a challenge because of the language and cultural differences. Everything we would do in a day would be colored with that challenge. As you can probably imagine, now more than ever, that kind of daily grind can really wear on a person. But I remember reaching a point in the Korean experience where a kind of switch went off in my head. One day I realized two things. First, that we would not be there forever. And second, that it was all a part of our main goal of saving up and paying off our student loans. Each of those cultural challenges was a part of being in a country that was helping us achieve that goal. When I kept these two things in mind, that we would not be there forever and that being there was helping us achieve our main goals, all of a sudden, the little challenges that I faced each and every day suddenly became little victories when I overcame them. It was a victory just stepping outside of my apartment. It was a victory communicating to the taxi driver where I wanted to go and actually arriving at my destination. It was a victory navigating the Korean grocery store and successfully getting what I needed to make nutritious meals. And so my life started to become filled with these little wins. Win, win, win. So that by the time I made it to work each day, I'd already had like half a dozen wins to start my day. You can imagine what that did for my mental health and how much easier the rest of my day every day then became. I've been thinking a lot about that experience in Korea lately as I've sought to slog my way through following all the COVID restrictions put on us by the government. The restrictions are tiring and tedious, almost like the culture shock of living in a different country. And that comparison becomes more salient every time I watch the news and see people protesting. They're protesting because all the restrictions make it feel as though we are living in a different country from the one we're all used to. I can relate. It's hard. I wake up in the morning and my family goes swimming at the aquatic center. And every day the woman working there at 7:30 in the morning is supposed to ask us a list of questions about whether we've had COVID symptoms, whether we've been in contact with anyone with COVID, or whether we've been anywhere where someone with COVID has ever been or ever even thought about going. Or at least that's what it seems. And then after swimming, we get home and we're low on breakfast food, and so we can't just run off to the store. We have to plan out a whole shopping list and order it for pickup the next day from the wholesale club. And then I go to work and I have to think about whether or not I have a mask with me, because even though we have probably 1,000 of those bloody things tucked away in every corner of our house and in our cars and in most of our jacket pockets, the one day that I don't think about it beforehand is guaranteed to be the day that I'll walk out of the house without one. And when I stop at Walmart on the way to work to pick up that box of Cheerios I forgot to put on the shopping list, I'll be forced to buy yet another mask for $3 from the front door security guard. By the time I just get to work in the morning, I've already had to change my normal behaviors at least half a dozen times. This kind of experience can easily lead even the best of us to feel worn down. In my sermon today, I want to talk about how to help flip that little switch in our minds. I want to help myself and all who are listening to go from weighing to winning, to see these little challenges we face during the pandemic as little victories and wins in our day. Because when it comes down to it, we are already winners in Christ. We are loved and known and chosen, as we heard in our gospel reading today. So let's see if there might be practical ways to actually feel this in our hearts today, in addition to just knowing it in our heads. If you remember, I said there were two things I realized that made my time in Korea go from weighing to winning, to realizations I might even call epiphanies. I realized that first, my time there was limited, and second, that every one of the challenges I faced was part of working towards a measurable and achievable goal. Those two things were very closely connected, because we were likely going to stay in Korea as long as it took to pay off our student loans. And this is very comparable, I would say, to us here today. We all want life to get back to normal. We all want to be together again as a worshiping community. We want to get back to loving God and our neighbors together in person. And just this week, our provincial government released a plan for getting back to normal and removing the restrictions, and it is based on one very measurable goal. I'm going to ask Lennis to bring that up on our screen, our Reopen Saskatchewan plan. Now, there's a lot of fine print on that. This is a visual summary. I'm going to be emailing it out to everyone this week. Remember to sign up for our email list. I won't read all the details on the slide, but instead would like to focus on one measurable part of this plan in which we all have a part to play. This reopening plan is based on one clear and achievable goal: people being vaccinated. This goal is kind of like paying off a loan. We've incurred a kind of debt by allowing COVID to spread, and now we've got to get to 70% vaccinated in Saskatchewan before the restrictions will be lifted. You can turn off the screen now, Lennis. But we've also incurred a debt by allowing COVID to spread around the world. So we've got to get the whole world above 70% vaccinated and keep it there to achieve a kind of herd immunity. Since people in many parts of the world do not have access to vaccines, we in places which do have access need to get as close to 100% as we can. And we will be in this pandemic situation until that vaccination rate around the world gets above 70%. Unfortunately, studies have shown that approximately 30% of people have hesitations about being vaccinated. That means that getting vaccinated ourselves and convincing people to get vaccinated are the ultimate goals toward which we all need to strive. Now, those 30% of people have many different questions and concerns about vaccines. Some of them are very reasonable concerns, and some of them are not. That makes it all the more important to focus on reaching out with good information to the people who are open to reason. This week, I will be emailing out to our congregation and posting on our social media some information which addresses the reasonable concerns about COVID vaccination. I encourage you to read it and forward it to your friends and family who may have concerns about being vaccinated. And if you're on Facebook, Instagram, or Twitter, to share the information there. That information will answer scientific questions, such as the safety of the various vaccines and the stringent processes that the vaccines have gone through to be approved. It also addresses various spiritual questions that people might have about the vaccine that keep people from trusting the scientists and government authorities. So that information will be forthcoming. Stay tuned. The important piece for my sermon today is that the roadmap that the scientists have laid out for us is dependent upon one thing, vaccination. That is a very practical and measurable thing. And even though all the challenges that we encounter in our day do not directly affect the vaccination rate, they are part of our being in a pandemic. They have allowed us to go about our daily lives while we waited for the vaccines to be developed and tested, and now as we wait for them to be produced and distributed around the world. Now, some might think I've spent a lot of time talking in this sermon about worldly concerns when a sermon is meant to be about heavenly things. After all, it's rare that I speak for the first 10 minutes of a sermon before hardly mentioning the scripture readings of the day, so I can appreciate where that thought might be coming from. Rest assured, I do plan on talking about our readings. But it is worth pointing out that the vision all of our scriptures portray of the end times is of a heaven and earth that have come together, of a resurrected Jesus who lives and breathes in a physical body. Any notion of a church and a faith that thinks that earthly concerns are unspiritual is simply untrue to the Jesus of this Easter season in which we currently find ourselves. In fact, one of my greatest concerns in us achieving herd immunity is not in getting enough Christians vaccinated, because we Christians are bearers of a story focused on self-sacrifice out of love for the other. We Christians can go about our day as we make sacrifice after sacrifice in our personal lives, knowing that all these sacrifices that serve the greater good and love of others are true to the heart of Christ. In our gospel reading today, we have Jesus' famous words, "To love one another as I have loved you." How did Jesus love us? First of all, he took on flesh. He accommodated to us. He entered into our experience, and he spoke our language. He had compassion on us, entering into our human existence. The temptation for the 70% of people who have no problem with vaccination is to become condemning of the 30% who have problems with it. However, if we Christians are called to love those people as Christ first loved us, it will mean entering into their experience, listening to their concerns, and first of all, letting them know that they are loved. Letting that person know they are loved will likely be more powerful than any rational argument you could make, because the heart is not rational. And we all have good reason not to feel loved at the moment. We've been separated from our family and friends, and being in a worldwide pandemic naturally makes one feel like we've been forsaken by God. But our scriptures are full of laments from God's people when they've experienced trials and hardships. And time and again in Scripture, God doesn't turn away from those who cry out. God binds up the brokenhearted. Let us do that for those in our communities and in our world who don't feel safe, who don't feel loved. Let us enter into their experience as Christ first entered into ours. Let us have compassion for them, just as Christ has compassion for us. That word compassion is an interesting word. Passion literally means suffering, and that prefix com means with. So compassion literally means suffering with. Each day as we encounter the challenges of our daily lives, let us see these inconveniences, these challenges, these trials as opportunities to have compassion and to suffer with our neighbors who are all going through these same things. And as we are faced with a situation which is ultimately dependent upon vaccination rates, let us suffer with our neighbors in Saskatchewan and around the world by getting the shot if it is available to us. Don't risk letting even one dose of AstraZeneca go unused and expire because people in India right now are literally dying by the thousands every single day for lack of vaccine. And with these new variants, the vaccine is hitting us hard close to home. I was just speaking with my brother-in-law yesterday, who is an ER physician in Edmonton. He was telling me that in the last week, he had to diagnose two little babies with COVID, one that was 10 weeks old and one that was only 28 days old. We're blessed to have little ones here in person with us here today, little Darren. Our sacrifices each and every day have the power to keep people safe right next door and around the world. Jesus also tells us today in our gospel reading, greater love has no one than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends. It's not just enough to have compassion for people. It's not just enough to suffer with. We Christians are called to suffer for others. Just as Christ suffered for us and laid down his life for us. We suffer for others when we get the vaccination for people who can't yet get it for themselves. We suffer for the people in India who have no access to vaccines. We suffer for the children who are too young to be vaccinated. We suffer for the children who are yet to be born. I remember growing up meeting older folks who had grown up during a time before there was a polio vaccine. And they were permanently handicapped because they'd contracted polio as a child. Many of us alive now grew up in an era where we'd achieved a kind of herd immunity to polio and mostly eradicated it because of the polio vaccine. Those people generations ago who received the vaccine were a key part of our ability to grow up without the risk of polio. They suffered for us. Let us pay it forward. Let us suffer for the next generation and be vaccinated. And let us get up each morning and see the challenges of each new day as an opportunity to love the people God has placed us here with. Let us wait patiently, doing what we can to prevent the spread as we watch the vaccination rates improve every day. We will get through the reopening phases. We will be able to throw wide the doors again and to gather in Thanksgiving. We just have to get those vaccination rates up. So let us do so in the love of Christ. Amen. We're now going to take our offering. Thank you so much for your generous partnership and mission here in Swift Current and around the world. If you missed your opportunity to place your envelope in the plate, you can leave it on your way out after we leave in the mailbox. Those who are online or by phone can donate on the internet, or you can call the office and arrange for your donation there. Thank you once again for your generosity. Our offertory hymn today is number 211, Good Christians All Rejoice and Sing. We will be singing verses 1-4. Please stand. Please kneel as you're able for our prayers of the people.
So I want you all to just sort of take a breath. Just breathe. Breathe in God. And just breathe out, you know, the stresses of the day. And let's do that 2 or 3 times. In and out. In and out. And one more time. Doesn't that feel better? I think so. Anyway, so in the season of Easter, if you're following along in your BAS, or Book of Alternative Services. We are on page 122. And the Easter prayers. So in joy and hope, let us pray to the source of all life, saying, hear us, Lord of glory.
Hear us, Lord of glory.
We pray, Lord, for in our Anglican cycle of prayer, we pray for the Most Reverend Dr. Linda Carol Nichols, our primate, the Most Reverend Greg Kerr Wilson, our metropolitan, and of course, the Right Reverend Rob Hardwick, our bishop here in the Diocese of Coppell. We pray also, Lord, for the bishop and the clergy of the Diocese of Eastern Newfoundland and of Labrador. We pray for the dean and council and congregations of Central Toronto. And indeed for the Greater Toronto areas. We pray for the Eastern Synod of the Evangelical Lutheran Church of Canada. We lift up, O Lord, our Bishop Rob as he prepares for retirement. And we pray for he and his family, for him and for Lorraine. And we pray, Lord, for our companion diocese of Mayinga and Litchfield. We pray, Lord, for our Dean, Mike Sinclair. We pray for the bishop and clergy of the people of the Diocese of Western Newfoundland, as I mentioned. And we pray, Lord, for the congregations of the Georgian, Huronia, and Bay Areas of the Eastern Synod and the Evangelical Lutheran Church in Canada. Indeed, Lord, we pray for our ecumenical partnerships with the Lutheran Church, the Ukrainian Catholic Church, and the Roman Catholic Church, and our covenant with each. We pray, Lord, that isolated and persecuted churches may find fresh strength in the Easter gospel. Let us pray to the Lord. Hear us, Lord of glory. We pray, Lord, that our risen Savior may fill us with the joy of his holy and life-giving resurrection. Let us pray to the Lord. Hear us, Lord of glory. We pray, Lord, that you may grant us humility to be subject to one another in Christian love, as our gospel reading tells us today. Let us pray to the Lord. Hear us, Lord of glory. We pray, Lord, for those who lack food, for those who seek work or shelter. Let us pray to the Lord. Hear us, Lord of glory. We pray, Lord, that by your power, wars and famine may cease through all the earth. Let us pray to the Lord. Hear us, Lord of glory. Here at St. Stephen's, Lord, we pray for our rector, for the Reverend Chris and Krista Dowdswell and their family. We pray indeed, Lord, for all of those who lead ministries and attend St. Stephen's. We pray, Lord, for those in all our hospitals and special care homes and those who take care of them. And we pray indeed, Lord, for all those who have asked for our prayers, whether for healing, help, or for comfort. We pray, Lord, for Glenn and Sammy. We pray for Michael and Verona, for Agatha, and for Ashton. And we pray, Lord, for those known only to ourselves. We pray, Lord, that you may reveal the light of your presence to those who are sick, and those who are weak, and those who are dying. We pray, Lord, that they may be comforted and strengthened. Let us pray to the Lord. Hear us, Lord of glory. We pray, Lord, that you may send the fire of the Holy Spirit upon all your people, that we may bear fruitful and faithful witness in his resurrection. Let us pray to the Lord. Hear us, Lord of glory. Amen.
Merciful God, you have prepared for those who love you riches beyond imagination. Pour into our hearts such love toward you that we, loving you above all things, may obtain your promises which exceed all that we can desire, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Let us join together as we say the Lord's Prayer. We're going to sing it today. Sorry.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive them that trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and
the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord look upon you with favor and grant you his peace. In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. We have a few announcements today. We received a message about a new initiative that the Anglican Foundation is running. So the Anglican Foundation is a grant-making agency in the Anglican Church of Canada. They are seeking to raise $100,000 for the Say Yes to Kids campaign. And in the fall, they are going to be inviting proposals to support Canadian children and youth in a post-pandemic world. So basically, they are going to be looking for creative ideas for how we can support children and youth as we start to come out of this pandemic. And so I emailed out the case for support for this campaign, and the campaign runs until June 30th. If you'd like more information, contact our office. Last week, we were blessed to be having Sammy Khalif Zoom in with us during our announcements time, and we heard about the new organ and tissue donation registry. Unfortunately, a couple days later, Sammy had quite a health crisis, and he had to be flown to Edmonton. Sammy is on the transplant list for a new heart. He's been waiting for a couple of years, more than that now, I think almost 4 years. He is not doing well. Please, please pray for him. And if you haven't yet signed up for to be an organ and tissue donor, I've emailed out the link to do that. It's www.givelifesask.ca. Coming up on May 21st to the 24th, May long weekend, is when we usually schedule the Camp Harding opening weekend. So our Anglican Church of Canada, or sorry, Anglican Diocese of Qu'Appelle camp for this area. It's in the Cypress Hills. If you've never been out, you're welcome to let me know that you'd like to come. If you have been before, please consider coming out. More information will be forthcoming this next week as we clarify with the park exactly what kind of restrictions there might be. At the very least, we'll be able to go out there and camp at a distance from one another. But we usually go out there, enjoy the camp, enjoy the outdoors, and maybe do a little bit of some projects out there to give a little love to the camp. It's also Mother's Day today, as I'm sure you all are aware. Happy Mother's Day. It's so great to have a young mother and grandmother here joining us. I know we have a few mothers and grandmothers here in the congregation. So we hope today is a wonderful day for you. We are also are fully aware that Mother's Day is also a challenging time for people that don't know their mothers or don't know their children or have broken relationships. Please keep all of these mothers in your prayers today. And I hope you have a great day. Coming up this week on Ascension Day, which I believe Ascension Day is technically on Thursday, but we will be celebrating it next Sunday. Between Ascension and Pentecost, we'll be participating in an Anglican initiative that's international and interdenominational called Thy Kingdom Come. It's a prayer initiative for those 10 days, and we're meant to pray for those who are coming to faith in Christ. So I sent out a link with some information on that, and I'll be posting that on our Facebook page and other social media channels on Thursday. I invite you to join me in praying along with them. And that is all of our announcements for today. I will be sending out information probably later on this afternoon about vaccination. I hope you enjoy reading it. I found this great resource, this website that compiles a lot of great information for Christians considering vaccination. So our closing hymn, our recessional hymn, today is number 374, Alleluia, Alleluia, Sing to Jesus. We'll be doing verses 1, 3, and 5. Please stand. Hallelujah. Let us bless the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.